Vibrat, Vibrat, Imamayam, Imamayam, Babu, वापु
भगवते
अकरो
द्वेषं
प्रचुर्वदं
स्मरन्
अनुस्मरन्
एवं
लब्धवरोदैचो
बिभ्रते
मामयं वपु
भगवति
अकरोत् द्वेषं
अनुस्मरन्
भ्रातुर्वादम् अनुस्मरन्
एवं
लब्धवरो दैत्यो
विभ्रते
मामयं वपु
भगवति
अकरोत् द्वेषं
भ्रातुर्वादमनुस्मरन्
एवं लब्धवरो दैत्यो
विभ्रते
मामयं वपु
भगवति
अकरोत् द्वेषं भ्रातुर्वादमनुस्मरन् एवं लब्धवरो दैत्यो
बिभ्रते
मामयं वपु
भगवति
अकरोत् द्वेषं भ्रातुर्वादमनुस्मरन्
एवं
लब्धवरो दैत्यो
Krishna, 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 Krishna
Namaste Sarasvati Dino, O Brahmi Prachai, hier wie sie schunden war, die Pastia, diese Teile. Mancha Kalpaturu Pestia, Kripas, Eva Tia, Fatina, Evio, Vaishnavi, Vio, Maha, Jai Sri Krishna, Chaitanya, Prabhupada, Sri Advaita Gadara, Shivas, Shivas, Penda, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So, yeah, here we hear about the poor Hiranyakasipu and how he continues to suffer in this material world because of his envy. This is the most miserable quality. It's the original quality that has brought us to this material world and is the cause of all suffering. Enviousness is such a quality that you can be in the most ideal situation like Hiranyakasipu. When you have Hiranyakasipu, he got all he wants, except actually mortality. But otherwise he gets everything, he becomes get control of the whole universe. Everyone is obeying his command. Even Narada Muni will also be somewhat compliant with his commands and like that. He is the sole ruler of the whole universe. Still he'll be miserable because he's envious. This is the nature of this quality, envy. It can, even if one is in Vaikuntha, if one is envious, one will be completely miserable. For example, we might maybe hold a great, ecstatic festival, Gaurpurnim festival coming soon. So it is. It's so blissful. It's lots of devotees. There's light. There's appearance day of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. What can be more blissful than that? Lots of kirtan, festivity and lights and prasad and so much service to do. And but if one in the middle of this, all this bliss, if one is actually sitting in the corner and foaming with envy, it will be a most miserable day. One will be envious of others. Why him? Who does he think he is? Why is everyone glorifying him? What about me? Like that. Envy creates any situation into misery. So we can have pity on Hiranyakasipu. That's his situation. He's envious and therefore he'll be miserable perpetually. He'll be miserable perpetually. So this envy is a really root cause of all the other anathas. It's a cause of our whole entire material existence, and the whole material existence is pervaded by this envy. It's pervaded by this envy. Therefore, this world will not be an ideal place. It can be. One can be. Anyone who's free of envy, actually, as soon as we're free of envy, then we will not be suffering. Then we'll be suffering with compassion. That's another kind of suffering, seeing the misery of other living beings and feeling sorry for them. But that's not what we're talking about here. Envy is the very opposite. Envy is characterized by being happy and joyful at the misery of others, and being miserable and suffering to see the happiness of others. That's actually what characterizes envy. Whereas devotional life is the very opposite. I don't have that verse. I have to learn that verse by heart because it's the essence of all religion. It's the eternal religious principle given in the sixth canto by the Dadichi Muni, that one who is happy to see the happiness of others and is feels pain at seeing the sufferings of others, his religious principles are called something like eternal and imperishable by those whose, you know, by grace or something like that. You know this verse, but nobody knows it by heart, the Sanskrit. But it is actually very, very essential. It actually gives what is the real essence of Dharma, of religious principles, a symptom of that. So we may be very, very, you know, advanced in many, many respects, materially advanced, even spiritually advanced, and we can, you know, we have all the external trappings of devotional service, and we know slogans, and our tilak is very straight, and we very, and we are, you know, punctual with our sadhana, everything. It's if we do not have that quality, that we are happy to see others happy and feel pain to see others suffering, then actually it's just, the whole thing is actually useless. That's a real symptom, that's a real quality that decorates a devotee, everything else is simply subsidiary. And that is, and we don't get down to more basic essence of principle, that we might go through all Dharma. You know, I'm part of like in what they call, you know, interreligious group, where the idea is to get down and formulate like a common ethics for all religions or something. But actually, the whole thing is just another form of envy. But really, the essence of all ethics, in religious ethics, is precisely this: to be happy with others, being happy, and to be miserable with others, being miserable. This is the ethic that should go through all religion. That, you know, if one has got that, then one has got true essence. And I think and it's not even difficult to get, everyone will actually agree with that when they see it. Yes, that must be the essence of all religion. But in the actual apply it, it doesn't mean like that. It's we have to be, one someone would say, we have to be happy when other humans are happy and miserable when other humans are miserable. That's very common. And say, yeah, what's wrong with that? Well, that's what's wrong with that is that there are 8,400,000 species of life. What about them? Should they not be happy also? Yes, humans can be happy, and we have slaughterhouses. That's and that's in practical religions. And when it comes down to it, the practicality, because Bhagavatam does not talk about humans; it talks about living beings. Starting with, you know, with every living being. And so if one is, this idea that humans are, you know, we are working for humanity, and the rest we don't care about, and we exploit them, and we have slaughterhouses and something like that. This is this wasn't the Nazis, you know, this is what the Nazis were all about. I mean, the German Nazis, just to use them as an example. I mean, they have only a bad name, but actually they have some good intentions. You know, it was actually an abbreviation of National Socialists, and most only focus on their one side. They were nationalists and they were racists, but actually they were also socialists. They wanted, you know, socialism with equal distribution of wealth and, you know, everyone, you know, like that. But for the Germans, the rest can get gas chambers. The Germans should have nice, you know. So you had the apartheid, South African apartheid system, where yes, we are the white race. We should there should be freedom and democracy and facility and like that. The others, they're just slaves, something like that. Of course, I experienced when it was in South Africa, actually. Many of the black people say it was better when we had apartheid. That's another story. Because you cannot solve material problems with material solutions. That doesn't work. But this idea that it's only humans we're talking about is basically apartheid. They have, you know, those who have the same kind of body that we have, those we are compassionate towards, they should have the rights. Those are our brothers and sisters. And the others we can kill and eat and use for our own sense gratification. The material world is filled with that. And ultimately it comes down to also, you know, all living beings should be happy. What about Krishna? He's also a living being. This whole Londoners interfaith that I was witnessing over the last couple of days is also, let's unite all religions by pushing out God. You know, all these different ideas about God and like that. If we just give up them and then we're just nice to each other, then we can all be peaceful.
That sounds like Buddhism.
That's Buddhism. But it's worst. And personally, I do not think it's possible to have interreligious harmony as long as there are Buddhists around. And I think they're Muslims, Christians, Jews, they are, you know, there's God. So then we have some common ground to speak on. But Buddhists, they are, you know, they are weird. They have the trappings, you know, the external, some of them dress like monks and nuns and like that. On Sunday I was invited to speak in a Christian church that had an interrelated religious happening or thing going on there. So I was there. And there was also a Buddhist nun, a Danish woman she dressed like a Buddhist. See, they dress the same clothes as Dalai Lama and like that, and she's a Buddhist nun. And so actually her lifestyle is maybe like ours, or maybe not, I'm not sure, I don't know how they, but I, you know, even given that they actually are living, like genuine monks, nuns, celibacy, and principles, and early up and sadhana, whatever they do, I don't know. But when she speaks, you know, she talks about, there are non-theistic religions. She mentioned that word, non-theistic religions. That's not possible. That's atheism. So how do you, how can a religion be non-theistic? Religion means how you connect with God. It means how to develop your relationship to God. That's what religion is all about. It's again establishing the lost connection with God. That's religion, that's yoga, that's what it's all about. So how do we have a non-theistic religions? It doesn't work. But that's, again, see, that's where the envy comes up. Even in the name of religion, this can rid of God. Even, in the name of religious unity and like that, we should get rid of God. Even though, they'll say we're brothers and sisters, all humans, we all one. There are 7 billion of us, and actually we're all brothers and sisters. Dalai Lama was speaking like that from the States. So then I should have, of course, I should have jumped up and said, we're brothers and sisters, who's the father? I think Prabhupada would have said, if you're brother and sister, that means there's a father. Otherwise, the word brother and sister have no meaning. But they don't think of that. I think we're just brothers and sisters, but we come from nowhere. We come out of nothing, sometimes we're just there. I think that's, Buddhism is not even, that's when you have something, they refuse to be rational and reply rationally when they cannot act, but otherwise they want to be, of course you always, you used in rationality, but then, as far as I understand, I never really have a chance to challenge Buddhists much. But you know, like questions. So, what is the ultimate cause of everything? Where does this universe come from? Who are we? Why are we here? What is the purpose of life? How do we actually achieve liberation? What happens after liberation? How does it all make sense? They generally will not. They would rather think that they just want to end up in absurdities. They try to meditate on absurdities in order to kind of transcend. I don't know what they're trying to transcend, rationality and like that. It's like the sound of one hand clapping. Meditate on the sound of one hand clapping, then you get realization. But of course, then the question is, what about the other hand? What's that doing in the same, in the meantime? That's my question. But, yeah. And so it's the Prabhupada has a very nice purport in the Chaitanya Charitamrita about Buddhism. It's when the Chaitanya was traveling down to South India. He met also with a group of Buddhists, and they had their guru, and he had some disciples. And Lord Chaitanya, he went there, and then he argued with the Buddhist teachers, although they actually they consider untouchable, the outside Vedic culture. But Lord Chaitanya somehow, out of his great kindness, he still argued with them and completely defeated them. So much so that they left, and they were so disturbed because they had been defeated by Lord Chaitanya, so they conspired to, they made a plot against him to degrade him, was the idea. So they brought a big plate of untouchable foodstuffs, which they came to say, this is Mahaprasad. That was the idea, and they wanted Lord Chaitanya to eat these untouchable things. So then they, they came with the plate, but while they were on the way, big bird suddenly appeared, an enormous bird came and grabbed the plate and flew up in the air with the plate and again dropped the whole content on the Buddhist and dropped the plate, and the plate fell and with the edge hit the head of the leader of the Buddhist, who fell unconscious to the ground. So then they were shocked, and the disciples of the so-called guru, they went to Lord Chaitanya and asked, help us, save the life of our guru. And then Lord Chaitanya said, you should chant this mantra in the ear of the guru, and then he'll wake up. And he gave the Hare Krishna mantra. So Lord Chaitanya initiated the disciples of the Buddhist teacher, and then they went and they chanted the Hare Krishna mantra into the ear of the guru, who woke up in ecstasy and chanted. So then, of course, that's only what Lord Chaitanya can only do that. But there, Prabhupada has a long purport about Buddhist, about the teachings of Buddha, or as it is now, because it's not really based on Buddha as such. Buddha broke parampara, and as a such, his whole parampara will be without parampara, and the standard is everyone speculates. So, and that's, and they don't have, you don't have to refer, because our founder didn't really refer to anything. So that is a tradition, we can just speculate, and they will speculate like anything. And actually Buddhism, of all the different religions, actually Buddhism is the one that is most scattered up in sects, actually. They're most, they're most different kinds of, so many different kinds of Buddhist sects, I have no idea about. And